A battle over who is to blame for high house prices has pitted Vancouver academics against Ottawa economists. One side blames Chinese immigrants and foreigners. The other says lack of supply is exacerbating local forces. Vancouver media have dedicated over 100 articles to the Vancouver studies. The Ottawa research, only 5. One side recommends demand suppression, especially against outsiders. The other says increase supply by repealing government anti-housing policies. Today, 69% blame foreigners for high prices. Only 18% believe anti-housing policies are to blame. Many media support the popular theory that China's wealthy have had more impact than anything on affordability. Even after CMHC revealed less than 5% of homes were owned by non-residents. The BC government has endorsed the theory that outsiders are to blame. What we know with absolute certainty is money raised in other parts of the world is distorting our housing market. Government is imposing protectionist taxes on outsiders, other Canadians, and even British Columbians with second homes. These rules are penalizing Americans, even while U.S. protectionism is threatening our economy. Homeowners must report to the government where they have been and provide proof of how many days they have spent in their homes, information to be shared with other government agencies. What evidence does each side offer? One Vancouver study draws conclusions by looking at the way homebuyers spell their names. Another notes that Canada invited wealthy Chinese to immigrate, that they bought expensive homes while house prices were rising, and concludes one caused the other. They dismiss the real estate board claim that prices are mostly strong job growth, population growth, and low mortgage rates. Yet they've failed to explain how a fraction of a percent added annually to the population could have such enormous effects. The Ottawa economists begin their study by reminding everyone that the presence of wealthy people does not raise prices. First, they develop a model for the stock and flow of the housing market with equations. 30 PhD economists, using massive data sets from Stats Canada and a $1.5 million budget, set to work, crunching numbers for almost a year. They found that by plugging in just 3 variables, income, population, and mortgage rates, their model predicted 75% of Vancouver's rising house prices, exactly what the real estate board had claimed. Then they went to look for the other 25%. They found it in the elasticities of housing supply. Vancouver has a shockingly inelastic supply curve, the worst in Canada. Edmonton, Montreal, and Calgary have healthy elasticities. Toronto is deficient at 0.5, but Metro Vancouver is abysmal at almost 0.25. Geography and anti-house supply policies are responsible for most of the rest of the price rises. Government cannot control geography, so government policies are to blame. These economists had identified the causes of Vancouver's high house prices without a single reference to Chinese people. Almost all rising house prices were due to income, population, mortgage rates, and geography, all amplified by government anti-housing policies. Contrary to popular belief, the report finds that speculation and investment demand have little impact on prices. Indeed, the calculations confirm the gap between predicted and actual prices is from supply restrictions. In fact, the report cautions government against targeting speculators, saying investors could be encouraging more supply than demand. It should be noted that most people in Metro Vancouver live in housing built by speculators called spec housing. What does the head researcher urge us to do? Find ways to increase supply. The research notes that Vancouver and Toronto have the strictest government anti-housing policies, rating highest on the Regulation Constraint Index. Yet Vancouver has a much lower densification rate than Toronto and Montreal. A house demolition elsewhere is replaced by a condo building. In Vancouver, it is replaced by a larger house. And Vancouver has a distinct lack of 3- and 4-bedroom condos. Vancouver first-time buyers have a high rate of family support. The report also encourages flexible housing systems for the new mobile agglomeration economy that stretches beyond city and even national borders. Might this economy require job creators to have more than one home? Government unwillingness to deal with supply is creating a society of haves and have-nots. The report notes, preserving enclaves of single detached housing will increase wealth inequality. They report alarmingly that in Vancouver, no home buyers believe the value of their homes will decline in the next 12 months. Governments must act carefully on facts, not on myths, if we are to get out of the current situation without precipitating an economic crisis. Blaming Chinese for problems has a long and disgraceful history in British Columbia. 100 years ago, the complaint was that Chinese men worked here and sent their money back to their families in China. Today, they complain the opposite. Chinese men make money in China and send money to their families here. Most troubling is that government housing policy appears to be based on research that scapegoats ethnic minorities and is demonstrated to be false. And it does the very things that the economists recommend against. How fortunate we are that so many skilled economists with the budget required have shed light on this issue that is so important to our economy, quality of life, and community harmony. Now it is up to us to act on their advice.